ushers to come forward at this time to receive this evening's offering. I'll ask Brother Gary Wilson if he will come ask the blessing.
Good evening. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, as we come before you, we thank you for letting us come this way. And Lord, we ask you, Lord, to just knit our hearts and minds together. And God, we pray, Lord, that we just receive the message that God has laid upon Chris's heart, Lord. We pray, Lord Jesus, that you'd touch each and every one that's hurting, those that has cancer, and those that are just suffering from some disease, Lord. We pray, God, that you just touch our body. And Lord, we ask you to touch those that have the give and those that have not. But we ask you to take this offering and let it be used for the building of your kingdom. We pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Give them a hand as they come sing for us tonight.
It's good to be in God's house tonight. And Brother Chris Morehart preaching tonight, he asked us to sing these two songs. And one of them we're familiar with, and the other one we practiced at about 4:40. And so that one's first. We're going to get it out of the way. But hopefully the Holy Spirit will move in your heart as we sing this. And it won't be about us. It'll be about Him. Amen? If y'all listen to the words, they're good. Amen. Thank you.
I think they did an awesome job. Let's give them another round of applause. Thank you both for doing that. That was a blessing. And it's good to see you all at church on a Sunday night. And it's about 20 degrees out, and it's going to get colder by the time we get out of here, so I appreciate you all being here. And I'm excited to be here. I'm humbled to be here, and I've got big shoes to fill, especially after this morning with Pastor Kyle. So I pray that this message will be well received. God put on my heart a message that I believe is going to touch everyone's hearts, because it's hard to avoid complications in this life. And that's kind of where we're going to go tonight. So as we, before we get into this message, let's just ask the Lord to join us tonight. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for this opportunity to come and speak your word, Lord. God, I thank you that we are here to be filled with your Holy Spirit, Lord, which will guide us through every difficulty in life, Lord. And I just ask that you would anoint me to bring your word forward, Lord. And God, that you would just speak a truth tonight, Lord, through me. And as a vessel, Father, I feel humbled to be here tonight. And God, I just ask that you would fill me with the right words, Lord, and allow me to speak truth to this church, Lord, and that somebody would be helped tonight as a result of the word that comes forth, Lord. I pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. So it's my intention tonight to bring you a message of comfort and good news in a world that seems chaotic and unfair at times, while at the same time speaking a word of truth that may sound a little bit like a rebuke. All right, so that's okay, because this word is sharp, right? That's what the Bible tells us, that the word of God is sharp as a two-edged sword. It may sound like a rebuke to you, but hopefully it'll cause you to reflect on how you deal with certain circumstances in your life and how you heed the word of God. Because let's face it, this life is challenging, and living this life in a fallen world is not an easy thing to do. You know, we often find ourselves acting and behaving like everyone else. And bless God and the Holy Spirit that Pastor Kyle's message on Wednesday and Pastor Kyle's message this morning ties in beautifully to this, and there's only one that can do that. So I hope that you remember something he said on Wednesday. I hope you remember something he said this morning, and I pray you'll take something out of this tonight and weave it all together for your life. Right? So every day I see people hurting and struggling with life issues. Anyone ever had a life issue? You know, that we all do. No, none of us are going to escape the issues of life, but what God put on my heart is to really communicate to you how he intended to deal with these things. Right? Many times, the people that I see that are hurting are good, strong Christians that are being beat up by the devil because they don't realize the power and authority they have in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Right? You need to know the power and authority that you have. See, we come to church on Sunday and everything's perfect. Everything is A-okay, right? Behind a polite smile and the warm hug or handshake, though, people are hurting inside. Right? We don't often get to communicate it because you're not going to stop and listen to somebody's life history in a passing handshake at church, but we've got to get real. But it is one of the reasons that I love this church in particular, because people come and they use these altars. They come down here. They come for healings, and they're healed here by the grace of God, for God's glory, because he'll receive the glory every time he brings a healing. And people come here to be healed emotionally, spiritually, and physically, and God gets the glory every time. So I do invite you here. If there's something on your heart tonight, I pray that you'd just get up out of your seat and you'd come forward to the altar here. But the truth is that life gets difficult, navigating the relationships, the jobs, the sicknesses, the financial issues, the loss of loved ones. These things are challenging to deal with, but it's, of course, not a surprise to God. You know, see, God knows exactly what we're going to deal with. Jesus went through all the same things that we're going to go through. In fact, the Bible's full of stories demonstrating pain and sorrow and anguish, right? We can read about them all. But the good news is that God, in his infinite wisdom, has equipped us with exactly what we need for every situation. It's my intention tonight to bring forth exactly how, and I think we all know it, or some of us know it, and some of us need a reminder here and there of how God intended for us to deal with these difficult situations. But I'll ask you, how do you deal with difficult situations? Do you go to an unsaved friend or coworker? Who are you talking to when you have a time of need? it's important that you don't go to the wrong person. We don't go to a TV help show. We don't go to Dr. Phil or try and fill ourselves with some other TV garbage because it's not going to help us, right? We can't go and get bad advice from somebody who doesn't have our best interest in mind. God has our best interest in mind. He planned it out for us, and He's sealed every believer with the promised Holy Spirit. And He sends His angels to protect and to minister to the saints, right? So we have an inside helper, and we have an outside helpers, right? So it's important to know that. Hebrews 1:14 says, are they not all ministering spirits to those who are the heirs of salvation? Right? Who is he talking about? He's talking about angels. Are angels all not ministering spirits to those who are the heirs of salvation? Well, if you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you are an heir to salvation, right? So we have the Holy Spirit as an inner help, and we have angels around us as external help. We are surrounded by God's presence. That's a good thing. So God's made provisions for us to live successful, blessed, peaceful, abundant lives. It's up to us to accept it and to live out our lives according to His word. Right? So we have a choice. The Bible tells us that in John 10:10, that the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy our lives. We know that verse, right? But what did Jesus say? The second part to that verse is that Jesus came to give us life and to give us life more abundantly. We need to focus in on the words. We need to know that Jesus came to give us life and to give us life more abundantly. So I ask you this, the next question, who are you going to believe? Who are you going to believe? Are you going to believe the devil? Will you go through life being defeated by the devil and your circumstances? Or will you believe in Jesus Christ and live an abundant, peaceful life that God laid out for us, right? So I'm just laying the ground here for the message here. As Christians, we know the way to Christ, right? In Romans 10, 9 and 10, the Bible says that if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and we believe in our hearts that God raised Him from the dead, that we will be saved, right? For it is with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And if we have found Christ, we have been sealed with the Holy Spirit. See where I'm going with this? It's the Holy Spirit that is going to guide us. But God's also instructed us to do a few other things. God says to pray. And His word says to pray continually. Right? Pray continually. God says to read His holy word. God says to know His holy word. And I'm going to give you some scriptures that drive this point home tonight. Well, here's one that we have trouble with. God says to obey His holy word. Well, we don't like to obey, do we? In our human fleshly nature, we don't like to obey. Here's another one. We need to humble ourselves because the Bible says in James 4:6, God resisteth the proud but gives grace unto the humble. And I can tell you, church, that as a Christian, when I was first saved, I thought I had it figured out. I thought I knew what the word says, but until I found this position right here, I didn't know what it was all about. This is the position that a 6'3", 220-pound man found to know that the truth of God. I had to humble myself and get on my knees and know that God is God, and I'm but a servant of His, and I need to be obedient, right? I need to obey His holy word. And I need to humble myself. So that take that one home. That right there is the best thing I can give you all night. Humble yourself before the Lord. You see, when we humble ourselves, we leave room for help. Right? When we think we can do it all on our own, we'll quickly find out that we can't. But when we humble ourselves and we get down on our knees, we'll leave room for help. We allow the Holy Spirit to do His job. Okay, so that's where I'm going tonight. The title of my message tonight is The Work of the Holy Spirit. If you would stand as we read the Word of God, we're going to read out of the book of John tonight in chapter 14, verses 15 through 31. This is where Jesus was promising the Holy Spirit. He says, if ye love me, keep my commandments, and I will pray the Father, and He shall give you another comforter, that He may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth Him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. See, the promise was that the Holy Spirit will be in us to help guide our lives. Continuing on in 18, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me, because I live. Ye shall live also. At that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. He that hath my commandments and keepeth them, he it is that loveth me. And he that loveth me shall be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and will manifest myself to him. Judas saith unto him, not Iscariot, Lord, how is it that thou wilt manifest thyself unto us, and not unto the world? Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words. All right, that's another key word. Keep that in your mind. He will keep my words. We're going to talk about that in a minute. And my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and make our abode with him. He that loveth me not keepeth not my sayings, and the word which ye hear is not mine, it's the Father's which sent me. These things I have spoken unto you, being yet present with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. We're going to come back to that one, right? He will keep my words, and the Holy Spirit will bring to remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. We need the peace that Christ can give to us. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If ye loved me, ye would rejoice, because I said, I go unto the Father, for my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it come to pass, ye might believe. Isn't it nice that he gave them a forewarning so that they would believe when the time came? Hereafter I will not talk much with you, for the prince of this world cometh and hath nothing in me, but that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, even so I do. Arise and let us go hence. So the key words there, and I'm going to be coming back to verse 26, but let me read that again. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I had said unto you. I want you to plant that one in your mind. Can you please be seated, and I'll continue. He's going to call to remembrance the things that he said unto them. So, like I said, I'm going to come back to that, but I want you to ponder on that for a few minutes. It's the Holy Spirit is going to call to remembrance the things that they were taught. Okay? So the promised Holy Spirit we heard is our comforter, our counselor, our helper, our advocate. So in times of trouble, in times of need, where do we go? Don't go to your unsaved friend or relative or mother or brother or sister. If they are unsaved and they can't give you the advice that you need, go to the comforter, go to the counselor, go to the helper, go to the advocate. The Greek word is translated parakletos, literally means one called alongside to help. One called alongside to help. Everywhere I go, I've got one called alongside to help. The Holy Ghost, he's with me all the time. He's in me according to the word. The Holy Spirit is the one who provides the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. In Philippians 4:7, right? We know that the peace of God which transcends all understanding. But where does that come from? It comes from the Holy Spirit inside of us. It's the Holy Spirit that enables us to grow in the likeness of Jesus Christ. Okay? All right, so how do we let the Holy Ghost do the work he needs to do? Title of the message is The Work of the Holy Spirit. How do we let the Holy Ghost do the work he needs to do in our lives to allow us to live the abundant life of peace God called us to live? All right, anyone have the answer? I've been saying it, it's the Holy Ghost. I've got a three-part solution for you, and the first one is admit. Okay, the first thing we have to do is admit. We need to acknowledge that we have struggles in this life. We need to admit that the things of this life are too much for us to deal with in our own strength. We need to recognize what Paul said in Romans 3:23, that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We're all of a sin nature. We're all facing the same struggles in this life. All of us have that in common. Whenever we walk in here, we all have those issues in common. What we don't have in common is how we deal with it. But we ought to, because we're the church. We're the body of Christ. We come in here, we hear the word. We're supposed to be reading the word. We're supposed to be taking it in and letting the Holy Spirit call to remembrance what we read or what we heard. We all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We also need to be aware of the wiles of the devil. Right? We have our own struggles, but we also have somebody working against us. We need to admit that there are things that stand in the way of us being able to accept help from the Holy Spirit. There are some other things in our fleshly nature that keep us from getting that help. Pride, anger, unforgiveness, other fleshly human desires. These things keep us from allowing the Holy Spirit to do His job in us. The Holy Spirit is here to help us. He's our counselor. He's our advocate. He's our comforter. We know all this from Scripture. Why don't we let Him do His job? He's trying to help us. If you would go to Ephesians 6 and 12. You ever heard the expression, don't bring a knife to a gunfight? Well, can't read with these eyes. Same problem Pastor Chris does. These things drive me nuts. I need him to read this, but not that. Ephesians 6:12 says, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." These are forces against us, church. We can't go, this is what happens in relationships. It's what happens with people in your workplace and in your marriages and in your other relationships with your family. We're thinking we're battling with each other, but we're not. We're battling against spiritual dark places, and we can't do it with our fists with our words. We have to go with the Holy Spirit of God to fight these battles. We can't bring a knife to a gunfight. We're just not going to win. Galatians chapter 5, verse 16 through 21. John David's been teaching in Sunday school class a great message on the desires of the flesh. Pastor Kyle talked about it this morning. Starting in Galatians chapter 5, verse 16, he says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lusts of the flesh." Right? If we walk in the Spirit, we will not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit. Pastor Kyle said it this morning. I don't need to repeat it again, but it's our fleshly desire, our fleshly nature goes contrary to the Spirit of God. So we need to live by the Spirit. We need to allow the Spirit to run our lives. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would. But if ye be led by the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. And I'm not going to go deep into these, but it's worth mentioning, because somewhere in the body of Christ, in this church, there are issues of adultery. There's fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies. The list goes on. It was 17 or 19 of these, right? Envying, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, which I tell you before, I have also told you in the time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. That should be a wake-up call. Pastor Kyle said this morning, it's time to wake up. It's time to wake up. The time is getting close. We don't know when He's coming back. We ought to have an urgency about us to save souls. The altar should be full every time we're in this church. We ought to be out there preaching the word. It's all of our jobs, right, Pastor? Senior pastor, the associate pastor, anyone who comes up here to grace this pulpit is only a teacher. We're only to get the message out to you, and then we all go out, and we're all supposed to spread the word. There's darkness. We live in a time where evil's abundant. If we go to Isaiah chapter 5, verse 20, "Woe unto them that call evil good and good evil, that put darkness for light and light for darkness, that put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. But it's 21 I wanted to focus on tonight. Woe unto them that are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. How many times have we tried to take control of our situations where we think we can do it all? We think we can solve our own problems. We're not equipped to do it. God didn't intend for us to do it on our own, but He did make plans for us. He did help us. He sent the Comforter. He sent the Counselor. He said, if you just accept my Son, Jesus Christ, for your salvation, I will seal you with the promised Holy Spirit. And it is the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Advocate, that will come and help us in our times of need. Number one is admit. We need to admit that we have those struggles. Number two is commit. We need to commit. We need to know God's Word. This really is the message that God put on my heart. We need to read, or if you can't read, you need to listen. We have every opportunity under the sun. We can't make an excuse for not knowing the Word of God. We can't say, I didn't have time to read, but we can sit down and watch hours of television, right? There's no excuse for not knowing the Word of God. If somebody says, I don't know how to read, listen to it. There's 1,000 different ways to listen to the Word of God. There is no excuse for not knowing the Word of God. God has taught us in His Word what He requires of us. Right? What does it say in John 1:1? In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. And then going into verse 14, and the Word became flesh. Bible readers, we know that that's Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came as the Word. He became flesh, and He dwelt among the men. The psalmist David wrote about how much he loved the Word of God. I just want to go through a few excerpts from Psalm 119 to just reinforce how he felt about the Word of God. In Psalm 119, and starting in 1 through 8, blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed, happy, right? Blessed are they that keep His testimonies and seek Him with their whole heart. These are happy people. Blessed, they're happy. They also do no iniquity. They walk in His ways. Thou hast commanded us to keep Thy precepts diligently, that my ways were directed to keep Thy statutes. Then shall I not be ashamed when I have respect unto all Thy commandments. I will praise Thee with uprightness of heart when I shall have learned Thy righteous judgments. I will keep Thy statutes. Oh, forsake me not utterly. We're going to skip through to verse 81 and just go through a few more. My soul fainteth for Thy salvation, but I hope in Thy word. I hope in Thy word. How love I the law? It is my meditation all the day. He loves God's word. Verse 103, how sweet are Thy words unto my taste, yea, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. He will direct your path. Order my steps in Thy word, and let not any iniquity have dominion over me. Order my steps in Your word. Are you following what I'm saying to you? There's one more that I didn't put on my notes. It's verse 140. It says, Thy word is very pure, therefore Thy servant loveth it. Thy word is pure, therefore I love it. I love Thy word. All right, I want to reinforce my main point here. In John 16 and 7, Jesus said, nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient for you that I go away. He's telling the disciples, He's telling us that it was good that He left. He's walking with them. They came to know Him, but He was telling them, I got to go. I need to leave, and it's good for you that I go, for if I not go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send Him unto you. He said, if I don't go, He's not going to come. Right? So you might be happy that I'm here. You might have fallen in love with me, and you know who I am, but I have to go. I have to go because I'm going to send the Comforter to you. All right, and let's go back to 14 and 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things, and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you. So here's what God laid on my heart. How can the Holy Spirit bring things to remembrance that we don't know, that we haven't heard? Now, I know all of you here on a Sunday night come on Sunday morning, and you hear the Word of God. You're hearing from Pastor Chris. You're hearing from Pastor Kyle. You're hearing from lots of other preachers, and I'm sure you're reading the Word because you're here on a Sunday night. But there are people who you know, and there might be people listening to this message that don't turn the pages of this book, and they don't understand, and they haven't absorbed it, and they don't feel like it's sweet to the taste. What is Jesus saying? He was walking with them, and he said, it's expedient that I go, or the Holy Spirit won't come. And then he said, he, the Holy Spirit, will call to remembrance all the things I've taught you. So what did they have that we don't? They had Jesus walking with them and talking with them and telling them. Well, so do we. Right? We've been given it in a different form. We have no excuse for not knowing God's Word. So the work of the Holy Spirit, the title of my message, how can the Holy Spirit do His work if we don't know the Word? The message tonight is know the Word. Know the Word so the Holy Spirit can do the work in your life. We all struggle with these problems. We all have financial issues. We all run into loss and death of a loved one or sickness and different challenges. We have children that we wish were doing better things, right? There's a whole long list of different things that we all go through, and we can all probably talk for hours about those things that are all going on in our life. We all have that in common. Why can't we all have in common how we deal with it? We raise our hand and we can say, hey, I was going through this problem. Well, what'd you do about it? I called on the Holy Spirit of God. I called on the mighty Holy Spirit to come in and fix it. See, the Holy Spirit's a gentleman. The Holy Spirit's not going to force himself on you. He's not going to step in where you didn't invite him. But when you invite him, he comes. He'll come in and he'll do the work that he needs to do. Right? So, if he's going to, the Word says he's going to call to remembrance the things that I taught you. All right, I want to repeat it because it really hit me like a ton of bricks. I was teaching a class on Monday night a few weeks ago. We have a Bible study that we get together with, and somebody asked a question, and I said, well, yeah, the Holy Spirit's going to bring that. But the Word says he's going to call to remembrance the things that Jesus taught. Right? So they had been walking and talking, and Jesus was teaching. So they had the benefit of when the Holy Spirit came after Jesus left, he called to remembrance those things that they were taught. Well, whenever I'm faced with a problem now because I've known the Word, I go to the Holy Spirit and he calls to remembrance. He tells me where to go. He tells me what verse and chapter to go to. That's what that's talking about. So when we're faced with these struggles, go to the Holy Spirit of God. But you got to do your part. You've got to do the work. So we've got to admit. We've got to commit. We need to know God's Word. We need to read and listen to His Word. He has taught us what we are required to do. We need to study His Word. We need to read it, know it, obey it, live it, and allow the Holy Spirit to do His work. The third one is we need to submit. It's kind of like obey, isn't it? We don't really want to submit to anyone. But if we submit to God, amazing things will happen. We need to humble ourselves before the Lord, and we need to stop trying to fix things on our own. And stop going to the wrong people to get the wrong advice. We need to let go and let God be God. We need to stop trying to figure out how He's going to provide the help we need and just trust and obey that He's already provided the helper. Romans 8 and 14 says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Are you led by the Spirit tonight? Are you being led by the Spirit in your life? Is anybody getting this? Because it hit me like a ton of bricks when I thought about that the only way that the Holy Spirit could do His job is by calling to remembrance the words of Jesus. Right? We need to know. I'm hoping that this is helpful for someone tonight, because again, we all struggle with this. And we might want to hide behind, you know, the smiles and the handshakes and everything, but the fact is we all struggle with something at some time. Right? You know, bless God for the Holy Spirit. Psalm 121 and 2 says, "My help cometh from the Lord." Right? That's in the Word. That's what Jesus would have said if we were walking with him. That's what the Bible says if we're reading it. Psalm 145 and 18 says, "The Lord is nigh unto all that call upon him, to all that call upon him in truth." We need to be truthful with the Lord. We need to tell him, don't think you're going to hide something from God. We can't hide. You know, Adam was in the garden after they had partaken of the fruit and did what God told them not to do. And he was hiding, right? He was hiding, and he thought, "Well, I can't even hide behind this. It's all glass." He was hiding. And God said, "Adam, where are you?" He knew what he had done. We can't hide what we've done from God. He knows all things. He knows our hearts. He knows our minds. He knows our actions. But he's our helper. He's provided everything we need to be successful in life. So we need to submit. We need to humble ourselves before the Lord. Stop trying to fix things on our own. I really have to tell you that the humility is a key. We need to humble ourselves in the sight of the Lord. James 4:10 says, "Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up." See, God resisteth the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Has anyone ever found themselves too proud to call on God? We have a great friend in Florida, one of our mentors. We always say, just stop, drop, and pray. Right? If there's something going on, just pray. Just stop, drop, and pray. There's no reason to wait. If somebody says, "I need prayer," have you ever found yourself, somebody says, "I need prayer," and you go, "Yeah, I'll pray for you." And then you just go about your business, right? That happens all the time. I've made a real solid point of when somebody says, when my wife calls me and says, "Somebody needs prayer," I stop everything I'm doing and I hit the floor. I get in this. This is my favorite position. This is my favorite spot because I know I'm humble before the Lord. The Word says that we can come boldly into the throne room of God. That's wonderful. He tells us, come boldly into his throne room. But I like to come humbly into his throne room. God's invited us in. Through Christ's sacrifice, he tore the veil. He allowed us direct access to the Father. We can go to him with anything, any problem, any time. We need a healing for a brother. He comes up. We call upon the Lord. We need spiritual healing. We need physical healing. We need emotional healing. We'll come up to the altar. Does somebody need some healing tonight? Does somebody need to cry out to the Lord tonight for something? Is it a family member? Is it a spouse? What is it? There's got to be something you need to cry out to the Lord for. Don't let your pride get in the way. Don't let anger get in the way. Don't let unforgiveness get in the way of you receiving the benefit that the Lord has provided for us. Jesus said, "I have come to give you life and life more abundantly." That means here on earth, not in heaven. We already know what life in heaven is going to be like. We don't have to worry about that. Jesus said, "I've come to give you an abundant life here, peace, abundantly." We need to accept that from the Lord. Right? So how are you going to let the Holy Spirit do his work? Let's not stifle the Holy Spirit. Let's not stand in his way of what he's trying to do. So I guess one of the questions, and Pastor Kyle alluded to this morning, is what are you going to do when trouble comes? Right? When trouble or persecution comes into your life, don't continue to act like you did before you were saved. If you're a saved Christian, what are you? You're a new creation in Christ Jesus. You're not the same old man or woman you were before. You are a new creation. Act like it. accept the gift of the Holy Spirit that God's given us. You're a new creation in Christ. You've been sealed with the Holy Spirit. He wants to help you. Trust me, He wants to help you. I've learned that. I didn't always know that, but I found out. You know, how do we deal with things in times of trouble? I remember when my mother was sick and she was passing, and then she ultimately passed, and we went to the funeral, and I was a fairly young Christian at the time, and I have a brother and a sister, and they asked me to go up and say a few words, and I was very close to my mother, but I stood like a rock at the pulpit there. And I didn't even know why. I didn't know how. And it didn't dawn on me till afterwards. And I think it was some weeks after my brother and my sister said, "How were you so collected when you went up and spoke at Mom's funeral?" And I had to think about it for a minute. I was a fairly young Christian at the time. But what I realized, it was the Holy Spirit of God. It's the peace that surpasses all understanding. He filled me because I needed Him. I needed Him at the time. That's what He does. He's the comforter. He's my advocate. He's my counselor. Think about those words. He can adjust to whatever we need Him to be. If I need a comforter, He's my comforter. If I need somebody to talk to because I don't know how to figure something out, He's my counselor. Or He's my advocate. He's my paracletos. He comes alongside of me everywhere I go. That makes me feel pretty safe. Safe in the arms of Jesus. Always watched out for by God. I've always got God's eye on me. And what else gives me comfort? I've got external helpers and I've got an internal helper. I am surrounded by the presence of God. That ought to help you tonight. I hope it's helping somebody. I hope you're thinking about this differently. I hope you can call upon the mighty Holy Spirit of God and have Him fill you tonight and always, not just while you're at church. You know, it's not about being a church. We need to live this out every day. You've heard it said 1,000 times, if not more, from this pulpit. Read the Word of God. Read the Word of God. Read the Word of God. It'll change your life. Have you seen it change your life? I have. What does it say in Revelation? The devil was defeated by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. We all have a testimony if we're saved by Jesus Christ. And there's nothing anyone can do to change my testimony. I know the man I was before. My wife knows the man I was before. I wasn't that bad, but I was not the man I am today. Thank God. Thank the Lord Jesus Christ, because His word is true. If I accept the Lord Jesus Christ, I am a new creation. I'm transformed by a renewing of my mind. Romans 12 and 2. Transformed by a renewing of your mind. It takes time. How does that happen? It happens by the Word of God. We study. We read. We don't have Jesus walking around and talking to us and telling us, but we have no excuse for not hearing it, not knowing it. And we need to call on the Word of God. I want to read it one more time. John chapter 14 and verse 26, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, He shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you." Go home and meditate on that verse. Read it and read it and read it. Read it again until it sinks in that the Holy Spirit will call to remembrance all the things in this wonderful book. If we just allow Him to. So as we get a song of invitation, there's a short message tonight, but I'm going to get you out of here on time, but I want to read you something from the Reverend Adrian Rogers. And this was, anyone like Adrian Rogers? I know we got a lot of Adrian Rogers fans in here tonight. And this was 20 years ago, but I really find it fascinating. It says, "Many people's faith," actually it's entitled, "Living Without Spirit's Power is a Sin," according to Adrian Rogers. All right, it's a good point, so take this. "Many people's faith becomes a burden because they don't understand the ministry and the power of Holy Spirit. I'd rather die than be sentenced to minister without the conscious filling and anointing of the Holy Ghost, said Rogers. Preaching from Ephesians chapter 5, Rogers compared Christians who don't understand the ministry and power of the Holy Spirit to a man who buys a new car and then pushes it everywhere he goes because he doesn't understand it has an engine. That's good stuff. Well, on the other hand, they say, I'm grateful that I have it. On the other hand, they are just in drudgery grinding out the Christian life. Does that sound like anyone you know? That you're just in drudgery? Grinding out the Christian life? That is not the life that Jesus intended for us. Jesus said, I came to give you life and give you life more abundantly. He didn't come and say, I offer you life so that you can grind it out begrudgingly. That's not the life that he called us to. The Christian life is one of joy and peace. How do we obtain that peace? I'm not standing here saying it's going to be perfect. I would never say that. The Bible says to expect persecution as a Christian. That's what the Bible says. I'm not standing here trying to tell you that life will be perfect. But I am telling you how God said we to deal with it. We can deal with it through the power of the Holy Spirit. Citing Ephesians 5:18, Rogers said, Christians are commanded to be filled with the Holy Spirit. If we're commanded to, then we ought to. This is a good one. It's a greater sin not to do what you ought to do than to do what you ought not to do. Did you catch that? Is there some good Adrianisms? He's always full of some good ones. It's a greater sin not to do what you ought to do than to do what you ought not to do. Roger said, it would be greater sin for me to come to this platform today not filled with the Holy Spirit than to come drunk, he said, which would appall most of us, but it's true. He said, if I were to come up here without the Holy Spirit of God in me, it would be a greater sin than coming up here drunk. If you're doing what you ought to be doing, you can't be doing what you ought not to be doing. That's some good stuff right there, too. If we're filled with the Holy Spirit of God, we're not going to want to sin. You know, that's most of our testimonies, right? We know that we're not perfect. None of us will ever be perfect. But if you've gone from that old man or woman who probably sinned a lot, and you compare it to the new man or woman, the new creation in Christ Jesus, we left that old man behind. We don't have that same sin nature. That doesn't mean we won't sin time to time, but we're going to sin less and less and less and less. And the Holy Spirit's going to convict us of those sins. If you're doing what you ought to be doing, you can't be doing what you ought not to be doing, he continued. If you are not now consciously filled with the Spirit of God, you're living in sin. Are you consciously filled with the Spirit of God? That's a good question to ponder. Because according to the Bible, if you're not, you're living in sin. He went on to say, there's never been a greater day, a greater age to preach the glorious gospel of our Lord and Savior than this day and age. This was 20 years ago. I believe it even more now. Rogers said, the Spirit must have complete control over the believer's life. That the control must be continuous, and there must be a conscious claiming of the power of the Spirit in the believer. I pray tonight that somebody's heart was touched. I pray that this was helpful to somebody. It was helpful to me when I realized that verse that I've read probably 100 times, it just hit me. Does anyone ever read the Word of God that you've read over and over and over, and it just, one day it just smacks you upside the head and it's something different? It's the living Word. It's the living, breathing Word of God. And sometimes it just hits you, and then he puts a message on my heart to bring it, right? And like I said, this tied together. I don't know if you noticed it or not, but it did to me last Wednesday. I noticed that what Pastor was preaching was close to this. What he preached this morning had elements of this. That's the Holy Spirit, folks. That's the Holy Spirit of God working. He's trying to tell us something. He's trying to tell us what we need from Him. We need His presence. What else is going to happen? If we fill ourselves with the Holy Spirit of God, we're going to go out and tell somebody about Jesus Christ. We're going to get out and we're going to save souls because we ought to have an urgency. We ought to have an urgency to see people saved. Jesus is coming back. His word says it. We're seeing prophecy fulfilled out in the world. He's coming back and we don't know when. But get an urgency to tell somebody. You can't do that but with the Holy Spirit of God. In conclusion here, as we wrap up, if anyone is here tonight and you know that you haven't really been filled with the Holy Spirit of God the way you should, you can come up and flood the altars and ask God to fill you tonight with the Holy Spirit. If there's anyone here who would like to know how to be filled, maybe you haven't been saved. If you haven't accepted the Lord Jesus and you're not benefiting from the Holy Spirit the way that I'm talking about, if you're wondering how to get Him, we can help you. I read Romans 10, 9 and 10 earlier. It says, if you believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead and you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, you will be saved. The Bible tells us when you are saved that you're sealed with the Holy Spirit of God. And then we can study the Word and we can call to remembrance the things that we studied. It's interesting. Does anybody remember the three things that I said? Admit, commit, and submit. You want to know how to get saved? Admit, submit, and commit. You need to admit that you are a sinner. You need to admit that you're a sinner and repent of your ways. You need to submit yourself to Christ and accept Him as Savior. And then you need to commit your life to God and live as a child of the Most High. Our heads are bowed. If there's anyone here tonight, and you'd just like some prayer, would you just slip up your hand to say, pray for me that I could call on the mighty Holy Spirit of God. I see your hand. Thank you. I see your hand. We'll pray for you. I pray that you receive the mighty Holy Spirit of God. I pray that you would call on the mighty Holy Spirit of God. If there's anyone here who needs to be saved, you need to call upon Jesus and repent of your sins, would you raise your hand? Would you like to know the power, the mighty power of God in your life? I'm glad everyone in this room is saved tonight. Why don't we stand and worship a little bit on our way out tonight, Matthew? Altars are open tonight. If you need God's presence, come. Come, don't be afraid to come to the altars. Ask God to fill you with His mighty Holy Spirit.
No one could explain.
Oh, there was
you. Amen. Well, praise God. That was a good message tonight. Thank you, Lord, for what you've put on our hearts tonight. God, I thank you for everything that you've done. I appreciate everybody coming out tonight, and in the spirit of first free will, I guess we need to get our arms up in the air. We need to exercise our way out of here tonight. Trying to do the best I can to fill in for the pastors, and appreciate you being here, and appreciate that you listened to me and what God had to say to you tonight. Let's get our arms up and praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We thank you for coming out tonight. Stay warm, and we'll see you here on Wednesday.